Hello friends, today we are going to discuss about mental status examination in child and adolescent psychiatry. I am Dr. Suresh Padadmat, Professor of Psychiatry, Head of Telemedicine Center, Head of Forensic Psychiatry Unit at NIMHANS, Bangalore. Before I start my presentation, I would like to acknowledge my teacher, Professor Shobha Srinath. She is the main author of a clinical practice guideline for assessment of child and adolescent psychiatry, and this clinical practice guideline was released on 2019 and it has been published in Indian Journal of Psychiatry. And this presentation of MAC is based upon this article. Along with this, there are some amendments which have been updated and also guided by Dr. Rajendra K.M. He is assistant professor in child and adolescent psychiatry, NIMHANS, Bangalore. And I thank him for guiding me in making this video. Let's discuss about mental status examination in child and adolescent psychiatry. The mental status examination is one of the components of detailed evaluation. It is also called as psychiatric examination and observation. All else, it is also called as mental status examination. It slightly differs from adult mental status examination because there are some general principles of MAC, especially in child. The first and foremost, the observation have to be made throughout the interaction with the child and the parents. That means as soon as the child enters the clinic till it exit, you have to observe the child. Then only you will get available information. Also, not one observation or one MAC. It has to be serial MAC to uncover the right psychopathology. And also, whenever you are doing assessment, you need to ask appropriate questions. That means developmentally appropriate, and depending upon the cognitive ability of the child, you need to ask questions. You should not ask complex questions and the child may not be able to answer. The child will be perplexed. Hence, it has to be simple and direct questions. And also, you need to make behavioral observation during the whole process of the assessment of a child. It's not just an MAC for 5 minutes. MAC is not a watertight compartment. It is from the beginning of seeing the child and the child leaves the clinic. Till then, you are going to make the assessment. But however, there are certain challenges in doing mental status examination. First and the foremost is if the child's speech and language is not developed very well, especially if the child is 4 years or 5 years, and the child's vocabulary is not there much, then it will be very difficult to do the MAC. Not only that, the child has a cognitive compromising or else intellectual development, there is a problem, or else mental retardation, what we call, if it is there, then the assessment becomes very difficult. Or else, if the child is hungry or thirsty, or else other biological needs like wanting to go to toilet. So these will impair or hamper your mental status examination observations. At the same time, the illness related factors, if the child is very depressed, it may not answer at all, or else the child is very anxious, like in social phobia, may not answer at all. Or else if the child is in schizophrenia, fearful, may not respond. Considering that also the illness factor also play a role. Not only that, the hospital environment, strangers, noisy surroundings may intimidate the child and the child may not respond. These are the various challenges in assessment of mental status examination in children. Let's see what are the components of mental status examination. There are 8 components, starting from general appearance and behavior, psychomotor activity, speech, thought, mood, perception, other phenomena, and cognitive function. Let me repeat, there are 8 components, and when you do the assessment, you need to ask appropriate questions depending upon the child's development and age. That's very essential. Otherwise, your observation will be completely wrong. Moving further, let's understand about general appearance and behavior. When you do the general appearance and behavior, first and the foremost, you will note the child's hyperactivity, impulsivity, temper tantrums, crying, self-injurious behavior, stereotypy, self-absorbed play, that will you will be commenting. At the same time, if there is a separation from the child, if the parents are called for the interview and the child is made to sit outside, or else if the child is brought for the interview and the parents are outside, how does the child behave? Whether the child maintains eye-to-eye contact, facial expression, and the hand gestures, or else non-verbal gestures, how is it? and also whether the child is cooperative for examination, ability to engage in conversation, and other relevant observation like dissociative spells, temper tantrums, aggression, clinging behavior need to be noted. Same, you also have to make an report clearly telling that whether the child has any abnormal movements like tics, mannerisms, stereotypies, motor perseveration, and catatonic signs. Also, check whether the way the child has dressed, and also whether child is very hygienic or if there are any marks or injuries on the body. This is the general appearance and behavior. Let's understand about the psychomotor activity. What is the child's motor activity needs to be commented. Whether the child is very hyperactive, whether there is an increased goal-directed activity, whether there is agitation, restless, or else there is hyperactivity. That needs to be commented. That is psychomotor activity. Moving to the speech. And again, if the child is very small, maybe around age of 3 or 4 or 5 years, you need to use various toys and also engage the child in the play and to do the interview for speech sample. If the child is from 7 to 12, then invariably you have to be very flexible and need to have emotional questions so that the child gets engaged. Whereas after the age of 12, the speech sample you will be able to get if the child is cooperative. Hence, depending upon the child's language skills and vocabulary, you need to ask questions. And also, you need to know whether you also need to speak the same language of the child. And you have to note the tone of the speech, how the child's vocabulary is there, how the child is able to make a sentences, whether it is able to give good words or complete sentences, how the grammar is there, tempo of the talking, that is the rate and speed, volume, how much it speaks, prosody, whether there is emotional intonation is there or is it monotonous, reaction time, whether how much time it takes to respond to a question. Those are all the speech assessment. Coming to the thought. In the thought, the thought is classified into form, stream, position, and content. It is almost like similar to the adult, and the same thing will be used here. But however, the thought assessment will be very clear in the clarity of the thought assessment will be very clear in the adolescent. Whereas in child, it will be very difficult. Hence, you need to know what is the predominant theme in the child plays. That needs to be documented. And the child version of the problem needs to be documented. Whether the child has suicidal thoughts or ideas need to be asked and commented. Coming to the mood, you have to comment whether the child's subjective mood and objective mood, congruent, appropriate, range, reactivity, and lability. Here, one of the tip is, if you are having the emoticons, cards or dolls, if the child is able to label the emotions, you can ask, how does the child feel, and in the past 1 week, how is it feeling? So those are the questions you can ask, and the child nowadays are able to name some of the emoticons. Coming to the perception, you need to check for hallucination, illusions, and pseudo hallucination. But however, you need to differentiate between the hallucination, fantasy thinking, and imagination about what the child is doing. So you have to clarify, and you have to spend a lot of time to clarify this hallucination and imagination or fantasy thinking. Other phenomena like derealization, depersonalization phenomena need to be checked here. Coming to the cognitive function, again, depending upon the child's cognitive ability, age of the child, and the development, you need to ask questions. Whether the child is conscious, alert, drowsy, or stuporous, oriented to time, place, person, the child may have difficulty in time, especially in the smaller kids. But however, the children will be able to name the person, especially mother, father, brother, sister, and for roughly they can also tell about the place. Look at the attention and concentration. Whether the child is able to persist with a task, a toy is given, whether the child is able to focus with the toy and is able to play with that, or the child gets easily bored and jumps from one toy to another toy and moves around very fast. That attention and concentration need to be asked. In adolescent, it is not difficult. You can ask like digit forward, digit backward, but especially in smaller kids, it is difficult. Memory, immediate, recent, and remote. Immediate and recent can be easily checked, whereas remote, sometimes the concept of time, the chronological event, it's very difficult for the kids. or the small children. But however, in the adolescent, it is easy. You can ask, what did they have in the morning, especially the breakfast? In the night, those are the questions can be asked. The name of the school, in which school they are there, the name of the teacher, friends, that can be asked. Cognitive function with regard to intelligence, general fund of information, comprehension, depending upon the child's age. If the child is in the age of 4 or 5, 6, you need to ask for the body parts, naming, colors, objects. Those are the things you can comment, and simple calculations can be done. In adolescent, it can be almost, you can go with the adult testing. Judgment, you need to ask for hypothetical testing and then need to comment. Insight, whether the child is aware that it has some problems, it attributes for what, and is it ready for taking treatment. On that basis, you are going to comment on the insight. So with this, with the MSE, need to complete with tasks given to the child. So during the assessment, or when you are taking history, you can engage the child for asking by giving some paper, crayons or clay to copy certain figures, to draw something, ask the child to draw a person test, or else ask the child to draw whatever it likes. Writing skills, arithmetic skills, play assessment can be commented here. And one important 3-wish test has to be done. 3-wish test is a window for the child's emotional health. So you need to ask, if you need to ask to the child, depending upon the age of the child, you should ask, if you could make 3 wishes, any 3 wishes in the world, what would they be? You can also, if the child believes in God, you can ask, if the God comes in front of you and gives you 3 wishes, what are those wishes you would like to ask? So that 3-wish test gives the child's needs, the child's understanding, and the child what it is looking for the forward. These are the things you can ask in 3-wish test. To conclude, my dear friends, mental status examination and observation of the child starts from the entry to the exit of the child from the clinic. Mental status examination is for a period of 1 month usually. And also, to have a good mental status examination needs to be augmented with a good clinical history from multiple sources, and also good clinical examination gives a valuable information for appropriate and accurate diagnosis and management. Thank you for giving your valuable time. Stay safe.